Jesus' supernatural encounter with Satan in the desert. Next on One Gospel. We're reading Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, taken from the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. You can follow along. We're reading from the left column. Then Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit, immediately was led by the Spirit from the Jordan into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan the devil. And in those days, he was in the wilderness, not eating anything, for 40 days and 40 nights. Afterward, when they had ended, he was hungry. When the tempter of the devil came to him, he said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." And then the devil took him up to the holy city Jerusalem, and set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, cast yourself down from here, for it is written, he shall give his angels orders concerning you to guard you carefully, and on hands they shall bear you up, that you do not dash your foot against a stone at any time." Jesus said to him again, "It is written and has been said, you shall not test the Lord your God." Again the devil took him up to an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, "I will give you all this authority and their glory, because it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. Therefore, if you will fall down and bow to me, all shall be yours." Then Jesus said to him, "Get behind me, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and you shall only serve him." And when the devil had ended all the trials, then the devil departed from him for a season. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels came and served him. So we're going to go into different aspects of this. We spent the last episode talking a lot about who Satan was, who the devil was, how was this word used over time, how many applications was it, from the physical to the spiritual. But now we're going to talk about details of the temptation itself and see where that leads us. We're going to start with something that is pretty far away in space, east to India. There are numerous legends of Buddha, although they were contradictory, being tempted by Mara, a demonic king. One of the earliest verses describing this from the Padhana Sutta has Mara saying,
"For 7 years I pursued the Buddha at every step, yet with the wakeful Buddha I got no chance, as a crow that hopped around a fat colored stone, thinking we may find a tender delicacy, flies away in disappointment. In disgust I give up, Gautama."
So, this was an early description of Mara saying he tried to somehow tempt Buddha away from his enlightened path. But for Buddha, he was on some sort of a spiritual journey where he was studying under masters in his area, and he was engaged in spiritual discipline. And this led him up to a point where he said he achieved a sense of enlightenment. Whereas with Jesus, this is a completely different path. There is no, he's working to get up to a point of enlightenment. From the Christian perspective, he was God incarnate and was therefore enlightened from the beginning. But even the minority Christian opinion of adoptionism, which we talked about before, where Jesus the man became the Son of God at the point of being baptized by God's Spirit, that wasn't a process for him. That was a spiritual rebirth. So although there is an analogy to be made, it's also very different. Additionally, the Christian tradition of Jesus was very early. His temptation by the devil was a tradition that was written down within a few decades of his death, whereas the evolving tradition of Buddha being tempted by a demonic figure seemed to have evolved over time and may actually have come after the tradition of Jesus was already recorded. Now we're going to look at Jesus' temptation, not eating or drinking for 40 days and 40 nights. Remember, this was immediately after he was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit led him to engage in this fast. So Moses had three different 40-day periods that were recorded in Torah. He was on Mount Sinai in the cloud of God's presence for 40 days and 40 nights before being given more of the Torah. This is after the initial giving of the Ten Commandments.
Exodus 24:18, and Moses went into the midst of the cloud and gat him up unto the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
So that was a period of time when Moses was given God's teaching. Because remember, Torah, which is often translated as law, its original meaning was teaching. So this was Moses being taught over these 40 days. But Moses later fasted 40 days and 40 nights on Mount Sinai. This is after the Ten Commandments were first spoken by God, but before they were written on stone.
Deuteronomy 9:9-10. When I was gone up into the mount to receive the tables of stone, even the tables of the covenant which the Lord made with you, then I abode in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. I neither did eat bread nor drink water, and the Lord delivered unto me two tables of stone written with the finger of God, and on them was written according to all the words which the Lord spake with you in the mount, out of the midst of the fire, in the day of the assembly.
Moses almost immediately afterwards fasted again, this time in mourning and repentance due to Israel creating an idol with a golden calf.
Deuteronomy 9:18, and I fell down before the Lord as at the first 40 days and 40 nights. I did neither eat bread nor drink water because of all your sins which ye sinned in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger.
Israel also had a 40-day period in the wilderness, which commenced shortly after the original giving of the Torah.
Numbers 14:34. After the number of the days in which ye search the land, even 40 days, each day for a year, shall you bear your iniquities. Even 40 years, and ye shall know my breach of promise. Deuteronomy 8:2. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee, and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no.
So you see, there was two distinct reasons that Israel was in the wilderness. One was for the generation that died in the wilderness to bear their iniquities. But for the next generation, which ultimately did enter Canaan, the promised land, it was to humble them and to prove them and to know what was in their heart, whether they would keep the commandments or not. So you can see for those people, the time in the wilderness was a temptation. So what we're going to talk about next is the actual dialogue between Jesus and Satan. Because when you look at the coloring, which I'll go back to that very quickly, you'll see that some things are in purple. Purple means that it is Matthew and Luke, but not Mark. And all of the dialogue between Jesus and Satan are in purple. And so there was a theory that Mark was the first written gospel. Now, that doesn't jive with Christian tradition, which written by Eusebius. He said that Matthew was the oldest gospel, but still, they say Mark is the oldest gospel, mainly because linguistically it's simpler, and maybe thematically it's simpler. And they said, so Mark was the first, so Matthew and Luke took parts from Mark, but then there's parts that are in both Matthew and Luke, which are not in Mark. And so they hypothesized that there was a common source for the two of them that they called the Q Gospel. And this would have been about 1/4 of both Matthew and Luke. So this section here, this dialogue between Jesus and Satan, if it is true that it came from the Q Gospel, this would be the first meaty portion of the Q Gospel. Now, the historical record gives no indication that there was another gospel that existed, but the historical record does say that there were truncated versions of Matthew's gospel. And I would say that that is possibly because Matthew wrote more extensively over time and there were just different versions of what he said, some shorter and some longer. So it is equally plausible that Matthew, an earlier version of it, is what Luke had as a source. And Luke used Matthew in that way, but he didn't have everything that we have available today. Another aspect of this conversation illustrates a fundamental issue that the One Gospel had to wrestle with, because the order of the events are different. Both Matthew and Luke start with the temptation of hunger, but Matthew has the temptation of pride, followed by the temptation of power, whereas Luke has the temptation of power, followed by the temptation of pride. Now, in the text, in Matthew 4:11, it says that then Satan left, to me implying that Matthew's order is more likely chronological than Luke's. And so I chose to go with Matthew's order and just rearranged Luke's. Now, for those who have no issue with the text of the Gospels being literature, it's really an irrelevant difference. For people that believe in the inerrancy of the Gospels, they have to think about this. Well, they have to say, well, is it possible that they're both true chronologically? The way to do that would be to say he was tempted more than three times. So maybe he was tempted with hunger, then pride, then power, and then pride again. Or he was tempted by hunger, and then power, and then pride, and then power again. That's somewhat ridiculous. So, not to dismiss it if someone believes that, but that's not what I believe. So, I think it is more likely that one of them is chronologically true and one of them is not chronologically true. I don't think that takes away from the actual truth of what is described, but that's how I deal with it. But this is a very minor detail. At the same time, it illustrates what you have to deal with for much of the Gospels. When you're trying to create it into one continuous narrative, you have to make choices, because the Gospels don't exactly follow the same order. And I don't believe that takes away from the truth of it, but for those that have an idea that inerrancy also means chronological truth, well, that's something that they have to wrestle with themselves. So next we're going to talk about Satan's first question: if you are the Son of God. So the context of it would almost sound like he's asking Jesus to prove he is the Son of God because he's not sure. Or maybe he's not sure that Jesus is sure. Now, of course, in adoptionism, that would be very easy to explain, that it would be a real temptation. Jesus might not be sure he's the Son of God, but that's not the majority Christian understanding of who Jesus is. So the more orthodox Christian interpretation of it could just be that, well, it's just a rhetorical question. They both know he's the Son of God. But it could also be that Satan actually doesn't recognize Jesus in his form as who he really is. Jesus says later in Luke that he saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. And it's often assumed that that's talking about some very early event. Satan fell from heaven, and that was the point he became evil or something like that. That is possible. At the same time, it might have been quite simply this event right here. I mean, how did Satan appear to Jesus? It doesn't say. The only thing we know that Jesus ever says about Satan appearing is that he saw him fall from heaven. Well, what does it mean to fall from heaven? From a science fiction point of view, you could say, well, he, you know, materialized like the, like, you know, like a Star Trek show. Or he came down, you know, heaven can also just mean sky. So he came down from heaven, like he flew down, or he came down in some sort of spacecraft because he's a non-terrestrial life form. Or he's an interdimensional being that just appeared. Whatever it is, Satan appeared. And the last thing to say when Satan asks him if he's the Son of God, you know, we talked in detail about what it means to be the Son of God as far as context goes. And, you know, we said there were angels that were called sons of God. Israel was called the Son of God. So, again, Satan may not have truly known Jesus' form. He may not have known what he was. He may not have known he was truly divine. Maybe he just knew that 40 days earlier there was a guy being baptized and the Spirit of God came down from heaven on him and a voice spoke and said, "You're my son." That might have been the first point that Satan knew that something was happening. Here we go with the phrase, "Man shall not live by bread alone." So this is Jesus' first response to Satan. It is a quote. He says, "It is written." It is indeed written. This was done, this quote came from the 40 days in the wilderness.
Deuteronomy 8:3, "And he humbled thee, and suffered thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna, which thou knowest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee known what man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live."
Jesus later tells his disciples,
John 4:34, "Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me, and to finish his work."
So the devil took him up to the holy city, Jerusalem, and set him on the pinnacle of the temple. Well, the temple was next to a deep ravine, so the pinnacle was quite a long drop. So how did Satan transport Jesus? Supernatural transporting is described elsewhere in the Bible. As we discussed earlier in the discussion of the Holy Spirit, Ezekiel was lifted up by the Spirit in multiple instances, providing him great visions. In the early Christian era, Philip had a dramatic instance of spiritual teleporting as well.
Acts 8:39-40, "And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea."
Now we're going to look at what Satan said, because he quotes the Psalms. Satan asked Jesus to prove who he was with a sign, quoting part of Psalm 91, but he conveniently omitted that obedience to Yahweh is the reason for divine protection.
Psalm 91:9-12, "Because thou hast made the Lord, which is in my refuge, even the Most High, thy is habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone."
Satan also quotes Psalm 90.
For thou, O Lord, art my hope. Thou, my soul, hast made the Most High thy refuge. No evils shall come upon thee, and no scourge shall draw night to thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up on their hands, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone.
So Jesus says, you shall not test the Lord your God. And this is also from the Torah.
Deuteronomy 6:16. Ye shall not tempt the Lord your God as ye tempted him in Massah.
Massah, which means temptation in Hebrew, was a place where the Israelites grumbled to Moses because they had no water to drink. Meribah means strife.
Exodus 17:1-7. And all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeys according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses, and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide you with me? Therefore do ye tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses, and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us out of Egypt, to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do unto this people? They be almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people, and take with thee of the elders of Israel, and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river. Take in thine hand, and go. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock of Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, and the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the chiding of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not?
Now we're going to look at the next phrase. He says, I will give you all this. Now you see that's in purple, meaning it's both Matthew and Luke. But it says in only in Luke, because it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. So why would Satan say all the kingdoms of the world have been given to him? Well, when we were talking about Satan in the last episode, we didn't bring up these verses because the direct correlation wasn't clear until we get to this verse. So here's three places where Jesus describes a ruler of this world.
John 12:31-32. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world shall be cast out, and I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all to me. John 14:30-31. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he is nothing in me. But so that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me a command, so do I. John 16:8-11. And when he has come, he will convict the world concerning sin, and concerning righteousness, and concerning judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. And concerning righteousness, because I go away to my Father, and you do not see me anymore. And concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world has been judged.
However, God the Father claims authority as well.
Jeremiah 27:5. I have made the earth, the man, and the beasts that are upon the ground by my great power and by my outstretched arm, and have given it unto whom it seemed meet unto me.
And Jesus has the authority of the Father.
John 3:35. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand.
Jesus specifically warns his disciples about choosing between God and the world.
Matthew 16:26, Mark 8:36-37, Luke 9:25. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul or himself?
So the Christian concept of the world is that there's dueling authority, where there's God and Satan, and both of them exercise some authority over the world. Here we have Jesus rebuking Satan and saying, "For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and you shall only serve him." Now, that exact phrase is not in Torah that I could find. But very similar verses are found that we could say as a paraphrase.
Deuteronomy 6:13, "Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him, and shalt swear by his name." Deuteronomy 10:20, "Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God, him shalt thou serve, and to him shalt thou cleave, and swear by his name."
So we've been looking very closely at how the Gospels use the Hebrew Scriptures. And again, for someone who has a very literal sense of what they believe inerrancy means, then they would have to say, well, this must be, you know, Jesus said this was written, so we must accept that there must be somewhere else that that was actually written. And there may be somewhere else where that's written. But for someone who believes that, you know, it can be true, but that specific detail doesn't undermine the truthfulness of this happening and this being true, they don't have that same issue. So we see here that the devil departed him, and Luke specifically says for a season. He'll be back. But when's he going to be back? Well, Satan played a role in Judas betraying him. And we had already given you those quotes when we were talking about Satan. But another phrase, which is, at the same time, Jesus says,
Luke 22:53, "This is your hour and the power of the darkness."
Now, angels came and served him. So Satan just tempted Jesus to rely on angels. But shortly after Satan leaves, Jesus is helped by angels.
Luke 22:43, "And an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him."
And that's an example of when Jesus was strengthened by angels at a later time. And Jesus says, while he's on the cross.
Matthew 26:53, "Do you think that I cannot now call on my Father, and he shall place beside me more than 12 legions of angels?"
So, when Satan said, hey, you know, if you jump off the edge here, you'll be fine. You've got angels watching you. He really probably did have angels watching him. It seems that they were around him. They weren't always visible. Well, they were actually pretty much never visible, except for that one event. But he knew they were there. So, presumably, Satan knew they were there as well. And again, what does that mean that they were there? Were they interdimensional? So they could appear in our reality at their will? Were they somewhere nearby where they could up in the sky or outer space. I'm not really trying to explain here, but because how could I don't know. But either way though, they were there. They were available the whole time. But he still dealt with his temptation alone. So we talked about a lot of things here. Some of it was pretty straightforward, you know, the parallels between Jesus and Moses, the parallels between Jesus and the nation of Israel. We looking deeply and taking the Gospels very seriously and taking them literally, we learn important lessons on how literal the Gospels take themselves. But what you can't get around in this encounter is just there's so many supernatural events. And you can use lots of prisms, lots of paradigms to explain what happened. But we saw satanic visitations, multiple teleportations, culminating with angelic help. And for Jesus' journey, this was only the beginning. So hopefully you'll stick around and we'll keep going on this journey through One Gospel. Thanks for your time. So let's